Good afternoon, and welcome to Gallaudet University. My name is Eric Klein. I'm a PhD in educational neuroscience. Welcome to Gallaudet University's PhD in Educational Neuroscience Distinguished Lecture Series. I am a first-year master's student in speech-language pathology.
My name is Terry Waddell Motter. I was a deaf school psychologist in the bilingual school for over 20 years and now a graduate special student with an interest in educational neuroscience. Eric and I are delighted to have the honor and privilege to present to you today Dr. Nora Newcombe, our distinguished lecturer in the Gallaudet University PhD in Educational Neuroscience Program, PENS program, Distinguished Lecture Series in Educational Neuroscience. The series is an important annual event and recognizes world-class cognitive and educational neurosciences. Our theme this year is Educational Neuroscience Pioneers, Revolutionizing the Study and Science of Learning in Young Children.
Today, we are especially thrilled to have Dr. Newcombe accept our invitation as our distinguished lecturer. Dr. Newcombe has her BA from Antioch College and her PhD in psychology and social relations, both from Harvard University. Currently, Dr. Newcombe is a professor of psychology at Temple University in Philadelphia, and she's also the principal investigator of the Spatial Intelligence and Learning Center. Dr. Newcombe has received multiple honors, including the William James Fellow Award from the Association for Psychological Science, the George Miller Award, and the G. Stanley Hall Awards from American Psychological Association, the Award for Distinguished Service to Psychological Science, also from APA, and the Women in Cognitive Science Mentor Award.
Dr. Newcombe is known for her research in spatial thinking, notably how important these developmental skills are in young children and how it can lead to success in science, technology, engineering, and math. These are subject areas in high school and beyond. In our expertise, American Sign Language has been proven to be a visual, spatial language. With Dr. Newcombe's research,
we are truly honored to have Dr. Newcombe here. She is a leader in the cognitive sciences and the field of educational neuroscience. She's really a big deal. Dr. Newcombe's lecture this afternoon is entitled Using Spatial Learning to Increase STEM Achievement. Please join us in welcoming Dr. Newcombe as our 2016 Distinguished Lecturer. It is indeed a great honor to have you here.
Well, it's wonderful to be here. Thank you very much for inviting me. So the pictures on this opening slide are chosen to give some initial idea of the spatial nature of a lot of scientific learning. The woman is looking at a model of a molecule, and it's a real model, so she could turn it and rotate it and try to think about its structure. The geology students are there at a cliff face trying to look at the cracks and think about what the pattern of the cracks tells them about what might be further into the cliff or how the cliff got there in the first place or is it going to move soon and fall down. And even when children are learning math, the numbers are evenly spaced along a number line. So that's a spatial representation of the numbers. So these are the kinds of considerations that have led a lot of people to think that science and math and technology and engineering learning are deeply spatial. But what the Science of Learning Center that I've been heading has been doing is to pursue that intuition in a series of steps. So our center is really oriented around these three ideas. First, there's the idea that spatial thinking is malleable, that you can become a better spatial thinker. If science were deeply spatial, but some of us were born to be spatial thinkers and some of us were sadly born not to be, that wouldn't be necessarily very educationally useful. It would just be a sad truth. So one of the important facts, if you're going to have a science of learning, is whether or not there's malleability there. The second idea, and you know, I kind of was already arguing for it, that spatial thinking is important to STEM success, but I was only making a verbal argument. I was only saying, oh, there's a molecule and that seems to be spatial. Oh, look at those cracks in the rock, they seem to be spatial. But we really need hard evidence. We need data to persuade ourselves that it's more than just a verbal argument, that there's some real truth there. And then putting those first two ideas together is the idea that you can improve science and math learning by harnessing spatial learning. And you could do that in one of two ways. One is to take an individual person, try to get them to be a better spatial thinker, to give them some kind of spatial training, maybe by a video game, just simple practice, and then somehow they would learn science and math better. The other idea, and one that we've pursued very, very actively, is that just as part of your regular teaching, part of the curriculum, you can teach it in a spatial way that encourages strong spatial thinkers to learn, that also helps weaker spatial thinkers both to enter the curriculum and also to develop their spatial thinking. So my talk today is going to be oriented around these three, or really four ideas, the two roots in number three make four all in all. So let's take the first one, the idea that spatial thinking is malleable. In 2006, which is when SILC got started and also when VL2 got started, we had some reason to think that spatial thinking could be changed. There were a few studies, but they were equally balanced by people who either thought that it couldn't be changed or thought that if it could be, it was only in a very local, basically uninteresting way. That if you got better at some very particular spatial skill, it didn't transfer to anything else. That is, you didn't get better at any other skills, you didn't learn math better, you didn't learn science better, so it was more of a stunt than a practically useful kind of learning. And the people who thought that, in fact, included these people who wrote a National Academy of Science report called Learning to Think Spatially. They said, oh, there's no transfer. So we did a variety of studies in the center to assess the idea that spatial thinking was either not malleable at all or not malleable in any interesting way. But one of the big things that we did, and the only thing I'm going to talk about today, is the meta-analysis that David Utall at Northwestern spearheaded. And this was bringing together hundreds of studies and really data from thousands of people where various people around the world had tried to get people's spatial thinking to improve. And we organized it into five different kinds of spatial thinking, but for now I'm not going to bother telling you what those five kinds are. What the important thing that I want to draw your attention to in this graph is the bars of improvement, the pre to post test improvement, statistically taking care of, well, you need a control group and so on. This is above and beyond that kind of natural improvement that you might get from taking a test a second time. And for all five of those skills, we find that people improve a substantial amount. It varies a little bit The one on the left is the smallest. The one on the right is the largest. But overall, this is about a half a standard deviation. So it's about the equivalent of 7 or 8 IQ points. Now, that's important, but also important is the fact that these effects were at least reasonably long-lasting. They lasted 3 to 4 months. And when I say 3 to 4 months, it's not that we know that at 5 or 6 months they aren't evident. It's that nobody was brave enough to look out 5 to 6 months. They were like, 3 months, that's a long time. And they did find an effect. So it's at least 3 to 4 months. And then the other thing is that we did find transfer. Now, it's not wide transfer. It's not from mental rotation to navigation. It's not from navigation to learning geoscience. It's more from mental rotation to paper folding, from paper folding to cross-sectioning. But still, it's transfer. So it shows that we have some reason to be optimistic about malleability. So I think that's been an achievement in and of itself, and indeed the fact that this meta-analysis has already been cited a lot, and it's only been out a few years, shows that a lot of other people are excited about it. But there are still a lot of remaining steps. I'd like to know durability for more than 3 to 4 months. How long can we get the training effects to last? I'd like to know if we can get wider transfer. If we can get some degree of moderate transfer, maybe we can get wider transfer. People haven't, again, been really brave enough to look yet. In terms of age differences, it's often assumed that young children are more malleable, more plastic, more able to improve than older children or adults. In our meta-analysis, we actually did not find that. Which is good news for those of us who are grown up. It means that we can also get better. It's not just for kids. It's in contrast to language, where there's been a lot of discussion, as you all know, of a sensitive or a critical period, and there may be even some truth to that. But for spatial, it seemed that the adults were just as able to improve as the children. Now, saying that it was not a significant age by training interaction, though, is not to say that it's not there. There's only a small number of studies of children, and of course they use certain child-friendly techniques that are not the same techniques as the adults are using. And it's possible that the children even can improve a little bit more. There was a hint of that. It wasn't significant. So I would like to see more interest in training of children. But that doesn't take away from the fact that adults can still really learn to think this way. Now, gender, everyone always asks me about male-female differences. On some of these spatial skills, not all of them, on some of them, women on the average do less well than men on the average. Now, that doesn't mean that women can't improve. Women improve just as much as the men. But what is often hoped is that women will improve more than the men, that the women will catch up with the men, that training will get rid of sex differences. And again, in our meta-analysis, we did not find that. We found a hint of it, but it was not significant. Now, it could become significant, though, perhaps if training went on. The training we evaluated was, you know, brief. People were there for a few hours, maybe 10 hours. You could imagine that, you know, working at something for a week, a semester, 2 semesters, eventually you'd get to, you know, you're as good as you can get, and eventually women would catch up with men. So we did not find that women equaled men, but that's not to say that that's impossible. And all of this is relative to finding what are the best methods. People aren't going to do anything that's boring, so how can we make it playful? How can we keep it varied? So I think there's a lot of work left to do, including my favorite piece of work that's left to do, which is how to figure out how to make people better navigators. There's been very, very little work on helping people be better navigators, and I think that's really needed. So let me go on to whether spatial learning really is involved in science and math. Again, there's a lot of what psychologists call face validity. Here are just a few more sort of face validity images. If you're doing epidemiology, in this case of the spread of AIDS and the HIV virus, you can put it on a map and you can color code it for when the virus was where in the Congo, and you can really get a great idea of spread and so forth. Or we have Rosalind Franklin trying to infer the three-dimensional structure of DNA from flat X-ray images that she had. But in 2006, there wasn't much more than that face validity. There were some concurrent correlations. People who did well in a physics class had higher spatial skills. Well, that's great, and maybe they got higher grades because they had higher spatial skills, but it's possible that, you know, it kind of goes the other way, that people with high spatial skills really self-select into physics classes. They like physics, they work hard at it, they get good grades. We don't really know what all the variables are from a concurrent correlation. Now, there were some, there was one longitudinal study that suggested a little bit more strongly that early spatial skills predict later choices of and success in science. But it was a study just of gifted children. So you went, well, maybe that's true for the gifted. It's not really true for everyone. And so one of the things that came out in the past decade that our center did not do, never mind. We had sort of started to do it, but they scooped us, but oh well. But Y, Lubinsky, and Benbow did a study of an unselected population. This is a very, very broad sample of hundreds of thousands of American teenagers in the 1950s who were followed as they chose or did not choose various kinds of careers. And what this graph shows is that if you take out their math skills, take out their verbal skills, take out their gender, take out how much money their families were making, take out a variety of factors, what you can see is that the people with right-going bars had higher spatial skills in high school. And those are the people who went on to be engineers, computer scientists, physical scientists, and so forth. And the people with the medium, not so outstanding spatial skills are the humanities and the social sciences. And the lawyers and, sadly, the future teachers have somewhat lower spatial skills. Now, we have built on this, the center has built on this, with some studies of children who were followed longitudinally. So one study that was done by my colleagues at the University of Chicago followed children from age 5 to age 8 and found that spatial skill predicted mathematical skill, and furthermore showed that the way it predicted was through that number line that I showed you earlier, that the children at age 5 with the high spatial skill were the children at age 6 who could space numbers evenly on the number line, and then those were the children who showed better math skills at age 8. So that suggests a mechanism for this relationship. It makes it less occult, less of a surprise. It's more like if we can put numbers on a number line, that seems really relevant to mathematical thinking. And another thing that we've done is to devise new tests or new assessments. So together with colleagues at the University of Delaware, we came up with some new ways to assess spatial skill in three-year-olds that involved copying a design. So either a flat two-dimensional design with colored shapes or a three-dimensional design with blocks. You have to look at that and copy it. And some of these are pretty complex. They're pretty challenging for a three-year-old to copy successfully. And we had a highly detailed scoring system where you could get partial credit just for picking the right blocks and extra credit for the correct one on top of the other but maybe at the wrong angle. And you know, I won't go into the details of the scoring system. But what we did find is that three-year-old spatial skill predicted five-year-old mathematical skill. So this is a complicated diagram, but I'll just walk you through it. We have spatial at age 5 predicts math at age 5. That's a concurrent correlation. And it has an arrow because in this overall structural equation model, it fits better with the arrow going that way, from spatial to math, rather than from math to spatial. Now, in terms of the three-year-old variables, which are here, and then the four-year-old tapping is an executive function measure that was taken at age four. So executive function predicts math. Spatial, which is our test, TOSA, the test of spatial assembly, predicts spatial, and spatial predicts math. So basically, the spatial and the executive function are both predicting math, but by different routes. They aren't overlapping routes. They're different routes. Meanwhile, the math scores at age three either don't predict the math scores at age five, or predict it only very, very weakly. And last, we have the Peabody Picture Vocabulary Test, the language at age three. And this exerts an influence by increasing spatial scores at age five, which of course then increase math at age five. And I'll say a little bit more later about why vocabulary might influence spatial skill in a minute or two. So this is an interlocking web of relationships, but the takeaway message is that not only does space at age five predict space at age eight, but space at age three predicts space predicts math. Space predicts math, whether it's from five to eight or from three to five. And we've also done a similar study from age about five to age about eight in Switzerland with a former postdoctoral fellow of mine, Andrea Frick. And this used a variety of other measures. The mental number line showed up again as a predictor of later math. We also got spatial working memory, which may interest some of you. And we got some other measures that we had come up with, a measure of scaling, a measure of proportional reasoning, and then our old friend mental rotation. And inhibition, which is executive function, which is something non-spatial, but we kind of know that that's generally important in academic achievement. So from a variety of age ranges and countries and measures, we have this idea that spatial, in fact, does longitudinally predict math with appropriate statistical controls. So I think we have a pretty strong kind of case to be made for spatial learning being involved in STEM. We have a lot of remaining questions. These are just a few of them. But more important, we have the idea of how we are really going to harness this and how we would know if we could use it effectively. So here I'm getting to my proposition number three, the two routes. One is the influencing individuals, training in the individuals, and the other is making the curriculum more spatial. So this is from the meta-analysis, and this is about the idea of training individuals. And it's kind of a thought experiment. You have a normal distribution of spatial skill. You train people, so you move it rightward, and we move this one rightward as much as the meta-analysis show that you can move the distribution rightward. And then we got a cutoff from that longitudinal study of high school students who later selected careers of what the average spatial score of people who went into engineering was. So we have the light gray being the people who would be sort of spatially qualified to be an engineer, and then the dark gray being the added people, the extra people who would be spatially qualified to be an engineer if we did more training. So it's a thought experiment, but it suggests the possibility that that extra training would work of individuals. People like Cheryl Sorby are very actively pursuing this idea that you should give individual spatial training to individuals. And there are a few studies that are experimental, random assigned. You get spatial training, I'm going to give you some other kind of plausible training. For instance, tell you about how great it is to be an engineer. You'll save people's lives. The bridges won't fall down. They'll have all sorts of new gizmos that'll enrich their lives. Won't it be great? Don't you want to be an engineer? I mean, this sounds like good stuff for getting people to be engineers, too. So you need to have an active control group. And in those designs, we are starting to get some idea that the people who are spatially trained do better in chemistry, in geoscience, in physics, and in calculus, and a few studies with math outcomes of kids. But we don't have enough of them. So clearly, if we want to have a strong causal case for train individual skills, get better science and math learning, we have to do more of this. And David Utall is working with Cheryl Sorby on an evaluation of her kind of training. The University of Chicago group is working on some real experiments in spatializing the math curriculum. I think we will know more soon about whether spatial training is a good way to go. But there is a problem with individual spatial training, even if it works. And I actually think it probably does work. If we, you know, did the studies right and we really evaluated it, I think in a decade we are probably going to have some good evidence that it works well. But taking out an individual child or an individual college student or maybe a small group of college students and giving them training is time consuming, and the curriculum is crowded, and we don't really have the space to incorporate that kind of training into the curriculum. Recess because we have time, because we have to do more academics, and no time for art, and no money for music, and we're getting rid of things. So the idea that we're supposed to add something, I think is just a non-starter for a lot of educational policy. So that's why we've been very actively interested in the idea of using spatial tools to spatialize the curriculum. So you're just learning math, you're going to learn it more spatially. You're just learning chemistry, you're going to learn it more spatially. So we have several groupings of these tools. And I'm not going to have time if I list the 8 or 9 tools by the different age ranges. Use them in by the different science and math subjects you could use them in. I did this back of the envelope calculation. It's like about 225 cells of types of tools by age, by subject. And so I'm not going to be giving you examples of things we've done in all of these different cells. I just want to give you a flavor for the sorts of things that I think can really be accomplished. So the first grouping is symbol systems, which is language, words like motion and region and area, maps like this map of the Grand Canyon. You see this, you denote it that way, or diagrams like that diagram of a geological slip fault. So just looking at language, I want to go back to, remember I promised you that I would say a little bit more about the Peabody Picture Vocabulary Test predicting spatial at age 5. So this is a different study taken from the Chicago group, again, from their longitudinal language study. And what they found there is that the parents who use a lot of spatial language have kids who learn a lot of spatial language. I mean, that makes sense. If you hear it, you're more likely to learn it, right? It makes perfect sense. The most interesting thing is that the children who develop a lot of spatial language have higher spatial skills. They do better on a spatial test. So that is, actually this was done first, but the two longitudinal studies kind of replicate each other. There's something about having spatial language, which you get from your parents, that increases your spatial skill. Now, this could work a variety of ways. It might be that if you have a lot of spatial words, you can talk about the spatial world, and then people point out more things, and they talk to you more about it, and they do things. Maybe when you have the words, you pay more attention to things. If you can talk about it, you look more at that part of the world that is spatial, and you think about it. So we don't quite know how it works, but when you think about it, at least the spatial language predicting spatial skill makes perfect sense. I don't know exactly, the Peabody Picture Vocabulary Test is obviously not only spatial words, but some of the words are spatial words, and it would be interesting to really see if those were the ones that were most important. But so spatial language and spatial skill really work together. Now, switching to a different symbol system, maps, and switching to a different age, high school. Let me give you another example of spatializing the curriculum. Oh, and you might say, well, what do I mean spatial language from parents' curriculum? Well, you know, when kids are preschoolers, they don't exactly have a curriculum, but they have a home curriculum where you're doing things with them. You're playing with puzzles or blocks, and so you're talking to them, and if you're using spatial language, you're giving them a good curriculum and that kind of thing. So for preschoolers, play is the curriculum. For high school, obviously, they have a real curriculum. So one of the projects within SILC has been the high school geospatial semester, which David Utall has studied together with Bob Colvard in Virginia. So it's learning to use geographic information systems, which the basic idea of geographic information systems is laying one map on top of another map on top of another map on top of another map to look for patterns. So how does the world relate to land usage, relate to elevation, relate to who owns the land, relate to where the streets are, relate to where the customers are? I mean, you can just go on and on. But what you can get out of this is a lot of information about who's going to go where when or what to do when or this kind of thing. So it's a very powerful tool, actually, for one thing, advertising and marketing. But the high school students are using it in projects in the course of a semester. This is just an example of one of the high schoolers' projects. This is in Virginia, in the mountains, in the western part of Virginia. And sometimes bears wander down out of the national forest and they're in people's backyards, which, as David is fond of pointing out, is good neither for the people nor for the bears. The bears don't really want to be there either. So this high school student was thinking about, well, so what do you do with the bear? I mean, imagine, you know, you can tranquilize them, hopefully, and get them in a truck, but then where are you going to take them? Where they're far enough away that they won't wander back, where you can get there in a big truck, where maybe you're not wasting gas, where when you let them out, they'll have something to eat. So he learned to layer these maps with the streets and the where the bear habitats would provide things to eat and so forth, and came up with a plan as to how to relocate the bears. So that's all very cute. Sounds great. If I had still a child who was in high school, I'd want them to do this. But the question is whether or not it's affected their spatial thinking. So we've spatialized the curriculum, and have we actually improved their spatial thinking? And I think the answer is yes. So they did a clever kind of evaluation in which they asked people questions like, if you were running for a local political office, how would you organize your campaign? And they had a control group of people who were in an AP class who did not take the geospatial semester. And they coded how much spatial language there was in their answer. The AP students gave, you know, perfectly lovely answers about the candidate should give a poll and find out if people approve of their stance on irrigation or, you know, whatever. I mean, it wasn't like they weren't smart people who had something to say. But the people who had taken the GIS class talk about finding data and plotting it on a map and looking for patterns. And in fact, when you just make a graph of their spatial words, their spatial words go up from before at the start of the semester to at the end of the semester, and the AP students' words actually go a bit down. And so at the end, there's really a massive different number of spatial words. This is now being carried forward in a pretty big project, which is out of Georgetown, where they're looking at the impact on spatial skills like mental rotation, and also a project that we have underway at Temple, where we're looking if people who learn GIS get better at forming cognitive maps. So we're taking this to another step. Now, a second grouping of spatial tools that we've worked with, we call learning from action to abstraction. And this also is several tools. One of them is literally action, the whole idea of embodied learning, that you have to feel something to really learn. most of us feel this can be a little overdone. There are some people who think that embodied learning is the only kind of learning, but we do think that embodied learning is an important starting point in many kinds of learning, including some kinds of science learning. And this example is moving to physics as a domain of study, moving to college in terms of an age that we're studying, and looking at embodiment. It was done by Contra, Lyons, etc., in C. and Bilek's lab. And this is trying to teach angular momentum. So what you're offered is the ability to either hold or to watch someone else hold two bicycle wheels. And they're either spinning together, or, and this is a task in itself, they're spinning one way and the other way. And then you have to hold them so that they track, so that they stay vertical with respect to this line. And it's actually pretty easy to do it if they're going together, and it's pretty hard to do it. You wobble a lot if they're going in opposite directions, so you're actually experiencing angular momentum. And what this shows is that in two studies, the action group and the observation group, who gets to see that the other person is wobbling when the two things are spinning, they sort of see the stuff, but they don't feel the stuff. The observation group does not improve, but the action group does improve, suggesting that embodied learning is helpful. Now, another kind of action to abstraction comes from gesture. And now we're going to move back down to preschool, down to that age, and move to mental rotation as a spatial skill. So this isn't a science or math subject. It's an actual specific spatial skill. This is a really simple example where you have two shapes, and you either move them together or up like that, or sometimes you have to rotate them. And when you rotate them, you can easily indicate that with a gesture. But when kids do this task, they don't necessarily gesture. It's kind of weird. Some kids just sit there and they don't do anything with their hands at all. Other kids actually gesture and say nothing. They just do this and then point to something there. And what the Chicago folks had found in one study is that people who gesture do better. In this study, they were wondering, if you get kids to gesture, does that help them to do better? So they randomly assigned kids to gesture or not gesture, to only point. And they also had experimenters who either showed the gesture or did not show the gesture. It turns out it didn't matter what the experimenter did. That was irrelevant. So again, this is an embodied message. But when the kids gesture, it really helped them. Interestingly, in the prior descriptive study, the boys were more likely to gesture than the girls. So this hints at the kind of training that you might be doing with preschool girls, which could be as simple as use your hands. It's little things sometimes. Now, I'm going to stick with gesture for a little bit, but switch back to university students and talk about some work that we've been doing at Temple with reading topological maps. So these are flat, two-dimensional maps that tell you about the elevation where you're, say, hiking or looking for oil or whatever it is you're doing in this terrain. And they're actually pretty hard to read. Novices really struggle with visualizing the 3D terrain and figuring out the contour patterns. And actually, women struggle, sadly, a little bit more than men do. Whereas people who use these a lot, people who are geologists or hikers, actually experience a sort of visual pop-out. They look at these maps and they just sort of go bling. They kind of almost see it in 3D. So you can actually get very good at interpreting these maps. And the question is how to get from the spot where you don't know what it is to where you really know what it is. So one thing that we did, and this is part of a lot of Silk's effort, is coming up with assessments. We came up with a way to test whether or not people can really read topological maps. So here the task is, you look at the circle, you look at the square. If water were flowing from one place to another, draw the path and the direction that the water would flow. And the correct path is shown in blue because water goes downhill, right? So it's going downhill. And also it follows the contour lines. So you have to look for the V shapes and follow the contour lines. But quite a lot of people draw a straight line from the top to the bottom, distressingly, because they do know that water flows downhill. They're not crazy. But they weirdly think, well, downhill is down? This is a very weird thing to think about a map, but that is how they think about it. So we have a variety of those kinds of items. And the question that we asked was whether or not gestures could help. But if gestures could help, then what kind of gesture? If you ask expert geologists to tell you about topological maps, they will make gestures like this. So they'll do this when they're looking at a mountain part. They'll do this when they're looking at a valley. They'll do this when they're showing you a slope. These are the gestures that people naturally use to describe topological maps. So we use those gestures as we talked about the models and the maps. But we also thought that another kind of gesture that might be helpful is one that they also do some of, although they do it a little bit less, I think, actually, because they probably don't need to, but to just take the contour lines and to point at them and trace around them, to emphasize the line is the line is the line is the line, those are all the same height, and really help people to trace those. And we had two control groups. So in blue, we just gave them the map test, and we didn't teach them anything. And this is how much they can get, 30-some-odd percent of the items right if we just didn't teach them anything. If we give them a standard textbook verbal description of how to read a topological map, they do a little better. The red is higher than the green, but they're still not doing very well. What we're calling 3D visualization are those gestures, and that is better than no instruction, but it actually is not better than just giving them a text. What was better was what we're calling pattern identification, which was the pointing and tracing. And we thought that was because they need to get the concept of elevation, of the line as joining points of equal elevation. So in a second study, we actually did something a little different. First of all, we sorted the topological map assessment into items that really emphasize learning the shape versus items that really emphasize needing to know the relative elevation. And then we tried to get them to focus either on shape or on elevation with the gestures and with the words. And what we're finding is, I mean, it almost amounts to if you teach them, they will learn. But if you teach them in a way that emphasizes visualizing the terrain, they start to do better on the shape items, that's the purple, but not better on the elevation items. The control group is the dark green. So, but if you emphasize the analyzing of the elevation, which is in the sort of light green, they do better. And they are not improved on the shape. So basically, the task in learning topological map reading is to both get the concept of elevation and to get the concept of the patterns of lines that indicate shape. And we do think gesture can help, but it's not as simple as just gesture and it's going to work. So I just want to mention a couple of other things. One is that we've been working on a third kind of arguably embodied cognition, which is sketching. Now, sketching ultimately creates diagrams. You have to draw to get a diagram. But when you just sketch for yourself, you're not really sketching a neat diagram. And there is something embodied about it. And I've actually had some interesting conversations today about what signers do when they lay out, you know, situation that they're talking about in space. And there's something a little like that about sketching on a piece of paper, that you're laying out the spatial location and forcing yourself to think if this is here, then that's there, and this is over here. And that's a way that famously people make discoveries on the backs of napkins in bars, right? So a lot of people talk about drawing in science, and often there are worksheets where, oh, you have to, where does the blood go through the heart? Draw some arrows to show that. Or draw something on this geological diagram to show what would happen if there was an earthquake. The trouble with paper and pencil worksheets when they're used in college classrooms is they take forever to grade. So instructors take a long time, and they often like hand them back at the end of the semester, which is then no help in learning. So the idea of one of our thrusts, CogSketch, was to automate this with artificial intelligence to make it more possible to get spatial feedback really quickly from a computer program. So I won't go through, it was actually a major effort of artificial intelligence to build this thing. But what it can provide is feedback, where it suggests to people what they're doing right when they're drawing a geological fault, and what they're doing wrong and what they should change. So it'll say things like, student gets feedback on demand. This actually says, is this really the location of the hanging wall? CogSketch is very polite. It doesn't say, you idiot, why would you think the hanging wall is there? It says, is this really the location of the hanging wall? So you know from that it's not, right? And we've made these sketch worksheets for a whole variety of units in the geoscience curriculum. So this is an example of trying to harness both sketching and artificial intelligence to improve geoscience learning in the college classroom. We also think it can serve as a formative assessment. It can help instructors to diagnose who's getting it and who isn't. If you're asked to draw this, the novice sometimes will draw something very, very complicated and seemingly very faithful to the original, but there's no real understanding, whereas the expert may draw something that looks a lot cruder, but it has a lot of arrows on it, because what the expert is thinking about are the dynamic force relationships. So you can conclude from this where your students are at in the process of understanding. The last kind of spatial learning tool that we have is analogy. So I want to talk here about children, and then a little bit back to adults, and then I'm going to take questions. Deirdre Gentner is our expert in analogy, and one of the things that she and Susan Levine have done in the Chicago Children's Museum is see if they can help children to learn the principle that a diagonal brace gives stability to a structure. So this thing is going to be more stable than this thing. Now, that's also true over here. This one has a diagonal brace, so it's going to be more stable than this one. But here, there's so many different things between these two, it's harder to really zero in on, oh, that one has a diagonal. Whereas over here, they're all the same except for the diagonal. So this is a really brief intervention, because when people go to a children's museum, they don't want to learn anything. They just want to run around and have fun, right? So they just go and they shake these things and they see which are stable, and it takes like 2 minutes. They either do it with an aligned pair or an unaligned pair. And then we give them a transfer task. They have to repair a wobbly skyscraper, but it's not one that looks like this. It looks completely different. And the question is whether or not they use a diagonal brace. And this is really hard for 6 and 7 year olds, but having the high aligned pair helps them. Especially it gets the 7 year olds above chance, and it gets the 8 year olds a lot above chance. So alignment is something that can be used even in a really brief intervention to teach something to children about engineering. And then the last one that I want to talk about briefly, and I won't present all the data, is something that we've done at Temple, spearheaded by Elise Resnick, which is back to geology. It's really hard to think about geological time because it's so much time. It's billions and billions of years. And the geological time scale isn't any help, because you have to read it from right to left, and also it's not to scale. The pink stuff in the right-hand column is much, much longer than the other columns. So why geologists do this sort of beats me. It's a terrible learning tool, but that's the way it is. That's the way they lay it out. So if you align, very often people do stuff like this in the classroom. How long is your life? Oh, the dinosaurs were around as long as this on your finger, or, you know, imagine that the world's been around, this is the analogy they use, from your shoulder to your tip of your finger. Well, the dinosaurs have been around this long, we've been around only as much as your fingernail sticks out. Well, it's a good analogy, maybe, but they don't seem to learn much from most of these analogies that people learn. So what Elise Resnick tried is embedding your life in American history, and American history, and world history, and world history, and, you know, et cetera, et cetera, and doing multiple kinds of embedding. And she did find that this improved people's understanding of geological time. But the last thing I want to tell you, and I think this actually is even more important because geologists care about geological time, but we all care about big numbers, or we all ought to care about big numbers. There's a saying about billions of dollars that's attributed probably falsely to Senator William Proxmire. He apparently said billions and billions of dollars, soon you're talking real money. And when people talk about the federal budget, they often don't have any understanding of how much a billion really is. In fact, sinisterly, a lot of people apparently believe that 1 million is a half of a billion. Very bad. Can't understand a billion if that's true. So what Elise did was here lower is better. So she used her hierarchical alignment technique to teach either time or also to teach astronomical distance, which is much longer than you can imagine. And she found that teaching either using hierarchical alignment helped you to understand billions relative to if you use conventional analogies for both of them. That's the purple. And in that case, you made really, really big errors on a billion. So I think there are ways to use all of these tools that are quite particular to little kids need play, older kids need more targeted intervention. There are challenges in geology that don't occur in chemistry that are different from math. But there are these tools that kind of cut across the different ages, different subject matters that we could start to use to make the curriculum more sensibly spatial and to teach people better. So, thank you. Yeah. Question?
Thank you. Thank you so much. Does anyone in the audience have any questions? If so, please do walk down to the front. Anyone? Any brave soul willing to come down?
No.
There we are.
I can start over again. So the question is maybe just a definitional one, but I'm interested in your perspective. You talked about improving the spatial skills of children or of adults, and I wondered whether it's a matter of children or adults having a skill present in their wheelhouse or in their abilities, but just that they haven't been tapping that skill?
Uh-huh.
Or is it that they're learning something new, fundamentally, that they didn't possess before? So
right,
you see
right.
that maybe that's just
right.
how you look at it, or a philosophical question, but
I think it is a
think?
Little bit how you look at it. I actually, I have the, yeah, sorry, the lavalier. So Susan Levine and I recently went to a Salzburg Global Symposium that was called Untapped Talent, which is exactly the metaphor that you're talking about. And I think a lot of people like to think in terms of untapped talent of all kinds, you know, not just spatial. And in this metaphor, it's somehow there. You just haven't been paying attention to it. I actually think that's, although it may occasionally happen, I think it's very misleading. And the reason I don't like it is because it is most compatible with a way of thinking about human cognitive capacity in which, to take the strongest case, you're born with certain kinds of talent. So you may be going to be a great artist if only you would realize that their talent was there to tap, or going to be Einstein if only you realize that you should really do physics. And in fact, I think most of our thinking is hard won, that we work on it, that we develop it, that we realize it by doing it, and that the more you do it, you do it better and better. And this is very much of a piece with all these things people are talking about now, you know, the Duckworth grit idea, the Dweck, you know, incremental motivation kind of idea. Sometimes I think those people are a little too optimistic. I mean, I do think that I could practice a lot and maybe never run a 4-minute mile or become a concert pianist or, you know, those kind of things. But I do believe that relative to some limitations, I mean, I think we all have a reaction range where maybe we're more likely to be a great visual artist than a wonderful concert pianist. But there's so much room within that reaction range to develop that I really don't like the metaphor of talent.
Thank you so much for that incredibly fascinating talk. The range of examples that you gave are very, very compelling. My question has to do with one of the most fascinating claims that are made in your presentation, and that's about that the spatial knowledge is malleable and perhaps not vulnerable to the critical or sensitive period. And I'm just intrigued. So when I was learning child development, I remember, you know, we had to learn Herb Pick's work, and which showed that children go through very specific developmental stages of spatial knowledge. And it was very much wed with Piaget, where children had to switch perspectives from large to small scale, and that required this these kind of mental computations that they did to achieve that. So is that a specific and separate domain from what you're talking about? Because it seemed that the received view was that children went through very specific developmental stages at certain ages, and that this was quite predictable, and they had went from, you know, not being able to do those spatial perspective changing, and then they were able to do it. So
right.
Is there no development? Is there?
No, it's not to say that there's no development. But, well, let's just take perspective taking. There's been a lot of research on perspective taking. There hasn't been too much recently. It's been a little bit of a quiet subject. But that's because people challenged the idea of, well, the Piagetian idea of perspective taking was actually that you didn't develop it until 9 or 10. And then it was John Flavel who did various things that questioned that, at least for very simple kinds of perspective taking, like, oh, you drew a great picture. Oh, even fairly little kids will show the observer the picture with the picture part facing out, not facing themselves. So in that sense, they're not egocentric. And other people, Jane Ellen Huttenlocher and I, for one, showed that even more complicated kinds of perspective taking can be done to some extent by 3- and 4-year-olds if you ask a little bit different way than Piaget asked the question. Now, that doesn't, in a way, undercut Piaget, because if you ask the question the way Piaget asked it, you can't do it till you're 9 or 10. It's just to say that there's various different lines of, even within perspective taking, of developmental progress. But we do all go through them more or less. Now, we go through them at different rates. So you might find a 4-year-old who's terrible, a 4-year-old who's great. Traditional cognitive development has not looked at the error bars. The error bars are only a nuisance because it prevents you from finding the age differences or the age by condition interactions that you want to find. But there's a lot of information in the error bars. So when I talk about spatial skill, I'm kind of talking about the error bars. And even when, for some things, you get so good that there aren't any error bars, right? Like no adult without brain damage would say that what you see is what I see, right? They wouldn't pick the egocentric choice. They're at ceiling, there's no error bar. So in that sense, there's no malleability, because how could you get better? Everybody gives the right answer. But for anything where we still, you know, we're not perfect, we could do it faster, we could do it more accurately, and you can devise perspective-taking tests that adults have trouble with. You only have to make the display. They won't pick the egocentric perspective, but they'll pick the wrong perspective if it's complicated enough. And then you still have variability, and then you still have malleability. So I don't know if that was kind of a long-winded answer, but I think that the idea of rigid age progression is wrong. But even when you make it more complicated and say age for this, age for this, age for this, you're ignoring the error bars, and there's a lot of interesting information in them.
I just want to understand, in terms of relationship of deaf children who are learning ASL through their deaf parents, and obviously ASL having a spatial language component, are there been studies looking at 3-year-old deaf children and hearing children and looking at predictions relative to their math skill, their number of skills at 5 years of age?
No, and I was talking with Melissa's seminar about a variety of questions connected to this. I think the spatial skills of deaf children have been not very adequately studied at all. I mean, barely no information. Whether or not it would translate into some sort of advantage, I don't know. I think that sign language probably nurtures some spatial skills, but not others.
Right,
so
definitely.
The first task, as far as I can tell, is to document that. Like, people in this room probably nod just the way you nodded, but we don't know that in the literature. So I think that would need to be documented, and then we could start to ask questions about maybe how math is taught. Maybe it could be better taught to people who already have certain strong spatial skills. We know nothing about this, to my knowledge.
Because I look, if it was a certain way, then nurturing that to the age of 5 and then taking it further,
right,
would then allow deaf individuals to accelerate in the areas of the STEM areas.
So absolutely.
Yeah. So
right, right. You're not the first person today to ask me that, and I think it's really interesting.
I thought it was an obvious question.
It is fairly obvious, but I hadn't thought about it till today.
Okay.
Yeah, it's cool.
All right, anyone else? Do I see a hand up over there?
Before I ask my question, there are studies of deaf children's visual attention, and deaf children who sign do have vastly increased visual attention over hearing peers at the same age.
Mm-hmm.
So there is some data which suggests that signing and having to pay attention
mm-hmm.
to your parents who are signing to you.
Mm-hmm.
Increase visual attention.
Mm-hmm.
And in a bilingual environment can also increase things like executive function and other areas of cognitive function.
Mm-hmm.
There's also research that suggests that signers, or deaf signers, have a greater sensitivity to objects in the periphery. So they have a wider
mm-hmm.
they have a wider visual span.
Mm-hmm.
They tend to have a wider visual
mm-hmm.
span. The differences don't tend to appear until later in a child's life.
Mm-hmm.
So it appears over the course of childhood.
Mm-hmm.
So there are some suggestions that greater spatial abilities might arrive out of some of these more cognitive or things that are oriented more towards perceptual
right.
advantages of
right.
visual.
I would just want to be cautious about those findings
mm-hmm.
For the following reasons. I think visual attention is possibly I think it's logically prerequisite to the kinds of spatial skills that we've been working on, but I don't think it ensures their development. So that's why we would have to have specifically targeted studies of those spatial skills. Being aware of things in the periphery, I think, is probably not related to the kinds of spatial skills that I'm interested in. And the reason that I have for saying that is the kind of video game playing that Daphne Bavelier has studied.
Right.
Different games, a lot of them actually do increase your useful field of view, but the ones that increase your useful field of view do not necessarily increase your spatial skill, and that suggests to me that they're different.
Interesting, okay.
And what was the other thing you mentioned? There were those two, and there was something
I
else.
Think those are really the two.
Oh, executive function.
Executive function.
Oh, well, an executive function, I think, is pretty interesting and may influence math skills. It's just that the structural equation model that I showed you suggests that it influences math skill, but not through the spatial route, mm-hmm. just directly.
It's indirect.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That actually wasn't my question.
Okay.
I was just responding. So my question goes to the gender differences.
Oh, uh-huh.
Okay, so there are gender differences, so why? Is it cultural? I mean, is it like what Andy Meltzoff discusses related
right.
to, I'm a girl, girls don't like math, I don't like math, or is there something more evolutionary? You hear about the hunters and gatherers,
right.
that the hunters, the men who were out hunting had to have greater spatial skills in order, as a matter of survival.
Right.
My question is why?
Right. But okay. So I could talk for a whole hour.
I'm
just
sure
about
you could.
This. My first answer to this is, why is the question everybody asks, but why is not the most important question, and why is probably even a very unimportant question. As long as we know that everybody can improve, who cares why they were different to start with? It's kind of, from a practical or policy point of view, far from the most interesting question. So part of me resists the why question, even though everybody wants to ask it. And I do think it's scientifically intriguing. You know, you kind of do want to, so nature, nurture, whatever. So that's one thing, though. I do want to say that for policy purposes, it may not matter. But in terms of why, my answer is that I strongly feel that we do not know why. And there are people out there who would tell you, oh, it's hormones. The hormone literature is a mess, guys. They used to say it was brain laterality. That has been disproven. They used to say it was a sex-linked recessive gene. That has been disproven. The argument from evolution is a very shaky argument. It rests on a lot of assumptions. One is how we hunt, like how did primeval, and it probably was men because hunting is dangerous and, you know, women are a childbearing resource, so a culture would be well advised not to put them in danger. But they probably did things like dig traps and have animals fall into it or wait for them to come to a stream and throw things at them. Like, we're not fast. We're not, like, going out. And honestly, there's archaeological, anthropological evidence that is how we hunted. And furthermore, gathering, it's not like you roll out of your hut and there's some berries. You probably do have to go a certain distance to find the berries. The whole thing is kind of just made up. I'm actually very, like, the evolutionary story is made up. Where we do have direct anthropological evidence, it doesn't favor what you'd have to see favored. The hormonal evidence is a mess. The lateralization evidence and the gene evidence is non-existent. Now, on the other hand, I'm not necessarily going with a cultural story, because the cultural story isn't clear at all. I mean, every single cultural finding that there is can be accounted for by self-selection. The boy children look at these toys and they say, yay, I love it, I want to do it. And the parents say, oh yeah, let's do that, because you're taking a cue from your baby. And the daughters say, let's put some clothes on my doll. I mean, everything about how parents treat their kids differently can be accounted for that way. So basically, I say, we don't know. It would be interesting to find out. But it doesn't really matter, except we're curious. That's my answer.
Is there that it? Okay, one last question.
Okay, mine won't take too long. But speaking also to the practicality of all of this, I really like the translatable application into the classroom because there are cuts and everything happening so frequently now in education. But going back to the graph that you had earlier in the presentation, that most who do not have the spatial awareness end up being teachers. So I was wondering if the teachers' education in becoming educators would change, or would they would somehow instantly understand how to translate this knowledge that they evidently don't have much of to who they're teaching.
Right. So a few things to say about that. One is that when you, we have done an analysis, or rather David Miller, who's a grad student at Northwestern, did an analysis which isn't published, but he's just a whiz with big data sets. And he went in, and it's the elementary school teachers that are the lower spatial individuals. So that's good, because it means the high school science teachers probably don't have that problem. But it isn't good, because we wouldn't want kids in elementary school to be launched on that trajectory. And C.N. Bylock has some data that suggests that many of these elementary school teachers have spatial anxiety, and that spatial anxiety, and of course they're mainly women, and that spatial anxiety is transmitted to their kids, and especially to the girls. So it's a little bit of a vicious cycle. So one of the things that you can think about with teachers is to just get them to be kind of calmer, because what it takes to, and they have the same problem with math anxiety, what it takes to teach elementary school math, or to put together the kinds of things that little kids want to put together, isn't beyond their capacity. I have a personal story when my kids were young, and we got one of these little, like, you have to put together a sailboat kits. And I looked at this, and I was like, I wonder if I could do this. Like, there's a moment of little panic. But I was like, get a grip. You can't put together, like, 10 blocks to make a sailboat. So you just have to stay a little calm. You just kind of do it. But I think as long as people think it's okay to, when daddy comes home, he'll build the sailboat, then you're caught in the vicious cycle. So that's where I am kind of a fan of, it is the Dweck sort of thing. You have to have confidence you can be better. With preschool play, blocks and puzzles are the things that we have really found not only are good in and of themselves, but do elicit spatial language from the adults and from the kids that are interacting with them. There's also things like shape sorters and shape toys. The problem with a lot of shape sorters is that they only use the they use a very restricted set of shapes. They're not very inventive about what shapes they use. The triangle is always a little perky equilateral triangle, and kids often get the idea that a tilty scalene triangle isn't really even a triangle. But blocks and puzzles are wonderful, and there's lots of other spatial things, like, do you know Connect Four? It's a game where you have to drop checkers into things and make rows or columns of four. It's sort of like complicated tic-tac-toe, and you have to block your opponent from getting four in a row and stuff. So that, well, I don't know if a 3 or 4 year old could play it, but by the time they're 6 or 7. So, I mean, I think it's pretty obvious what the spatial toys are, and they're a lot of fun. I don't know. Oh, in terms of teachers. So teachers, we are working on trying to make the principles a little bit more transparent. For analogy, Lindsay Richland has produced, I think, some good articles trying to help teachers understand how to use analogy in the classroom. One thing that turns out to be important is you don't want to present like a math problem, wipe it off the board, and present another math problem and then start saying, oh, and this is just like the one we did before, because they really won't understand the mapping. You need this problem, and you have them here, and you go, and this aspect of this, you know, the 4 in this problem is just like the 7 in this problem. And that is reinforcing the analogy with a gesture. It's this one, and that one is that one. And that's a pretty simple, when you hear it, you think, oh yeah, why was I doing the one problem and wiping it off and doing the second one? It does seem kind of clunky. But teachers do it all the time. Lindsay has analyzed videotapes of math teachers, and they often do it sequentially. So I think there are some pretty concrete messages that we could get across to teachers.
All right, well, I would like to thank you so very much, Dr. Newcombe, for accepting our invitation to be our distinguished lecturer for this academic year. We have all learned so much this year, and it's been a tremendous honor to have you here with us. Thank you.
Oh, thank you.
For those of you in the audience, we do have a reception from 5:30 to 6:30 over at the Kellogg Conference Center upstairs on the second floor in the break lounge area. All of you are welcome to join us. So come on over for mixing and mingling, and thank you for coming.